Chapter 41. When a superior man heard of Tao, he cultivates himself diligently. When an average man heard of Tao, he is doubtful, vague and would give up halfway. When an inferior man heard of Tao, he laughs and thinks of it as foolish. If Tao is not being laughed at, it is not the great Tao. Thus, there is a traditional saying of one who is enlightened with Tao may appear foolish. He who is advancing in Tao may appear to withdraw. Great Tao is plain and simple, which can adapt to all circumstances, although it may seem uneven and rough. A man of superior virtue is like an empty, receptive valley. A man of innocence may appear to be disgraced. A man of great virtue appears to be deficient. A man who practices Tao and actively achieves great merits may appear gentle and meek. A man who follows his true self may appear to be changeable. Generosity has no rough angels. Great achievement is time-consuming and is slow to complete. A great tone has no sound. Great Tao is formless. It is invisible and has no name. It benefits all and fulfills all. Chapter 42. Tao gives birth to one. One gives birth to two. Two gives birth to three. Three gives birth to all things and all beings. All beings bear the negative physical form which is represented by yin and embraces the positive true nature which is represented by yang. With the union of these two, they arrive at a state of harmony. Men dislike to be the solitude, the unworthy, and the virtuous, yet the lords and nobles call themselves these names. Hence, things are benefited by being humble and damaged by profiting. What the ancients had taught, I shall also teach as such. A man of violence who is in disharmony between yin and yang, that is the physical body and true self, shall die of unnatural death. This is the essence of my teaching. Chapter 43. The softest of all things can overcome the hardest of all things. Regardless of being or the non-being, they all have to return to the empty void to express their gentleness. Thus, I have learned the benefits of natural actions without personal desires. Very few can understand the value of wordless teaching and the due act of natural way. Chapter 44. Fame and life, which one is of intimacy? Life and wealth, which one is of importance? To gain one but to lose the other, which is of harm? Therefore, if one's desires are great, one would result in exhaustion. Overstock shall result in heavy loss. He who is contented will not suffer disgrace. He who knows his true nature will not incur danger. It is in this way that one can long endure. Chapter 45. Great achievement appears to be inadequate, yet its use is never exhausted. Great fullness appears to be void, yet its use is boundless. Great honesty may seem to be accused of wrongdoing. Great mastery appears to be clumsy. Great eloquence may seem to be inarticulate. Movement can overcome chill. Tranquility can overcome the heat. Peace and calmness is the way to guide the world. Chapter 46. When the world lives in accord with Tao, fine walking horses can be retired form plowing the field. When the world fails to live in accord with Tao, even pregnant mares are used as war horses and we're forced to breed in the battlefield. The greatest crime is to have too much desire. The greatest disaster is not to find contentment. The greatest mistake is to desire for endless possession. Hence, when one is gratified with self-contentment, true contentment can then long endure. Chapter 47. Tao exists in one's own true self. It cannot be found outside of one's true nature. Hence, there is no need to leave the house to take a journey in order to know the world. there is no need to look outside the window to see the nature of Tao. The further one departs from Tao, the less one will be able to know. Therefore, a saint is wise to know without seeking it. He is wise to understand without seeing it. He is wise to accomplish according to the natural way. Chapter 48. In pursuing knowledge, one learns with intellect and desires. Therefore, one's knowledge is accumulated day after day. In pursuing Tao, one is enlightened with the true nature and thus diminishes daily one's worldly desires and knowledge. The continuous depletion of one's desires persists until one acts according to the natural way. By acting without personal intention enables one to accomplish all things. Therefore, to rule over the world, one must act naturally without personal desires. If one pursues with extreme effort, one shall fail to rule the world. Chapter 49. The saint has no set mind, he regards the wish of the people as his own wish. He is kind to the kind, he is also kind to the unkind. This is the true virtue of kindness. The saint trusts those who are trustworthy. He also trusts those who are not trustworthy. This is the true virtue of trust. The saint conducts himself in the world by harmonizing with all beings to be at one. The worldly people thus look up to him attentively with their eyes and ears. And the saint treats the people like a loving mother who loves her children unconditionally. Chapter 50. Men enter this world with life and leave this world with death. Those who work hard for living and longevity are comprised of one-third of the people. Those who are leading their life towards death are comprised of another one-third. Those who live with indulgence in passion and desire shall harm their life and invite death. This is comprised of the final one-third of the people. Why is this so? It is because men are over-concerned with pleasures of life and hence exhaust themselves with hard work of desires of greed. The wise one who knows how to nourish life with the nature Tao, when he travels, will not encounter fierce animals such as wild buffaloes and tigers. When he is engaged in the battlefield, will not be harmed by the weapons. The horns of the wild buffaloes are powerless against him. The claws of the tigers are useless against him. The weapons are of no avail towards him. Why is this so? It is because the wise one follows the great Tao and cultivates himself accordingly. Hence, a man of Tao will not perish.